Oh, hey. So, what have I been doing? Not much. The new HRO catalog came. And on the front here is some stuff I've been spending some time with. Yaesu FTM400DR mobile radio. Very cool looking. And the handy talkies. And I've actually had a chance to talk through the repeater. I don't have one. But Yaesu's been doing a beta test. They released, I don't know how many, bunch of repeaters out into the field to hams who have volunteered to test them out. And while I was doing the Yaesu radio review, one of those popped up here in the local area, so I was able to play through the repeater a little bit too. I've got some video of that, and I also shot the video I had talked about doing the demonstration between the D-Star and the Yaesu and P25 and DMR radios, got them all in there. I did that with a bunch of guys from down in Charlotte. I don't have permission yet from the league to play that video for you. So hopefully I'll be able to play some of that before the review comes out. And let's see what else. Oh, CQ Magazine has come out, the digital edition. Let me see if I can dial that up here. Great. It's not showing up. You can see it here on the monitor. And if I switch the video system to show that monitor, you see what's behind it. Strange. So anyway, I'll just do it here. CQ, the May edition has shown up in digital. And the April and May combined edition arrived in the mail. Do I have that sitting here? No, that's December. Thought I put it out here. But evidently I didn't. So that showed up. They're catching up. There's been a lot of pretty nasty email, some fairly nasty comments on the YouTube video that I put up on their Facebook page. And they left them up there. I don't know if you got, I guess you got the option to make some of that stuff go away. And maybe if there was some really nasty stuff, they made it go away. But yeah, people complaining, they left it there, so good for them. I sent Rich email asking if he'd like to come back on the program, and at some point he will, but he's not quite ready to do that yet. They're still getting the house in order. The thrust of some of the email was, we think they're going under, and I can't say that they're not. I don't know. I hope not, but I don't know for sure. So anyway, the May issue has arrived. And do the over-the-shoulder again so that you can see it up here on the monitor. The CQ Worldwide Mega Issue. What's going on down here? Oh, I've got a cat. Everybody likes to see the kitty cats, and here is the mouse. Mouse, you want to spend some time on my shoulder? Can you settle in up there? Okay, go ahead and climb. Okay, I've got my brain here to remind me of what's going on in this episode. Cindy and I had an anniversary. It was our 16th anniversary. That took some time. I took some time out from the anniversary weekend. We share an anniversary with her folks 2 days apart, but so we celebrate them together and went down to Charlotte to do that. And I took some time out of the anniversary weekend celebration to go shoot the video of the handhelds and stuff. And let's see. You can see in the shack here, the Yaesu radio is gone. The handy talkies are gone. Back to ARL. They were anxious to get their hands on them. So off they went. Don't have them anymore. Saw this on Twit a couple of weeks ago. Not last Sunday, but the Sunday before. Hopefully this will show up on the monitor.
Yeah. I want the show to be watchable. I want to get rid of these stupid screens and put some lavs on people instead of these dumb mics. You at least got rid of the cans, which was really bad. You see all these guys doing podcasting that had two big cans on their head, and then they got a big giant Hello. Mic. It's horrible looking. We don't want to see any of this. And, you know, and then there's the screen. It's you're more TV. You don't need the big microphone, the big dick microphone.
You know this. Oh, thank you. I didn't know you cared. This is a great idea for a show.
Have you ever seen the Tom Hartman show? He's got this huge mic in front of him. It's like he's on TV. What are you doing with a radio mic?
You're making Lisa uncomfortable.
She didn't design the show.
No, it's been this way forever.
I'm just saying it should be upgraded to something a little.
Hey, here's some good news. Amazon.
So I'm playing that because I had received more than a few complaints. I think they were all on QRZ about the big headphones and the big microphone. But I kind of like this version of podcasting or making online shows. You see it. I think the very first time I saw anybody do this was Imus. And I thought that was cool. He was doing sort of a hybrid, a radio show, but with cameras on it. And that's the way Twit started and other programs have started. ESPN's still doing some of that. I like it. I'm not going to lose the headphones with a big microphone, at least not for a while. What else? Okay, so hiding here in the background, you had seen my website. I want to talk about the shirts just a little bit more. This Tom, who's doing this for me, has added the hoodies and the sweatshirts to the lineup. And he's told me that they sold a few. I don't think that he's about to retire, but but he sold some. And so now you can have your choice. And once again, if you're coming to Dayton and you wear a Ham Radio Now t-shirt or sweatshirt or hoodie, who knows what the weather is going to be like, you better bring all three. And I see you. And I've got a camera in my hand. You will get on the show and get to say something on the show. Where are we going next? Well, let's see. Without new shows on, it's been a couple of weeks, maybe a little bit more than a couple of weeks. And I've explained what I've been doing, going down to shoot the Aris program. Oh, did I say the Aris program? No, I don't think I did. Went down to the coast to shoot video of a school contact. Dixon Elementary School did a live Aris contact. That's ham radio helping the students talk to astronauts on the International Space Station. I've been through a bunch of those now. My first was back in 1992, before it was the International Space Station, back when it was the space shuttle. And that was fairly early in the program. And I've been through a bunch of them, one a couple of years ago. So there was another one that got scheduled down in Onslow County, North Carolina. It's down by the coast, an elementary school. So Cliff and I went down there and we videoed that. I don't have it edited yet, but what I'll do is I'll stare at my screen and pretend and lay a little bit of the video in post-production.
My name is Lizzie Urquhart. My question is, what kind of medical testing does an astronaut have to go through to be physically and mentally fit? Over.
Okay, Lizzie, I think I heard your question. It is a very extensive medical testing of our entire body.
Now, everybody has seen Aris contacts. There's plenty of video out there on the web about that. So I've got the contact shot, and I'm about to shot it multi-camera. I'll edit that together. But in a couple of days, I'm going to go down there and do a more in-depth interview with the instructor, Betty, and the students and the hams who participated. And we'll talk about the various aspects of what it takes to get one of these things started. Then all the preparation, tons of preparation in these things. We had a lot of preparation back in 1992, but nothing like they're doing today. And that 1992 is part of the reason why they do so much today. So I'll go down and talk to them, and I'll put that together. And that program is going to end up being multiple programs because we'll show you the contact. We'll probably lead off with the contact. They take about 10 minutes. The space station in the orbit it's in is got about a 10-minute arc, from acquisition of signal as it crosses the horizon to loss of signal as it goes on, sun setting on the other side. And that's if it's going straight overhead. If you have something that's off to a significant angle, it's going to be a few minutes shorter than that. So it was very successful and everybody had a great time. But I'd like to find out more about how it came together, what everybody thought about it. And then now that they've had a week or so to reflect on what they did, what they think about it. So we'll go down there and shoot some more of that, and that show will come up in a little bit. So again, without a lot of new shows, I've been not seeing very many contributions come in, but there's a couple that I want to pay attention to. I got this letter from John Kennedy. John is a KD4ISO. And let me read this to you. I watch your show and I like it. Well, dear Gary Pierce, I like your show and I like it. The last one about the shirts, that's the last one that he saw. He saw two old microphones and the Motorola radio. He likes old microphones. Yeah, there's a couple of the old microphones in the background. There's another one up here. Excuse me. If I can bring this down without knocking everything over. This old Shure 664. I don't use it anymore. I should cut the cord off of it. Make it easier to handle, to shove around. I saw that you use a Heil microphone. Yes, this is a Heil PR40 that John Dvorak was complaining about. Did I mention that John is a ham? I forget his call sign, but John is a ham. The headphones are not Heil. No, these are Sennheiser. Sennheiser HD 280 Pro 64 ohm. Mouse, what's up? Okay, Mousy. So I bought these just before heading out to, I think it was probably Huntsville last year. I got the big Wirecast system. You can see that. Yes, this shooting system. I've got Pro Tools and Premiere Pro editing on it as well, but it's primarily the shooting system. And headed off to Huntsville with the PR40 microphones to lower the background noise. All that stuff I put together for doing better stuff at Hamfests, and as we'll talk about a little bit later on, I won't be using them very much for the Hamfests, at least not for a while. John continues, like your show in Ham Nation. When I'm in the shack, I can listen only. I can't talk. I need an antenna tuner. I've got a wire up in some trees, 80 feet long, hooked up to an ICOM 735. It works okay. So I'm not sure why he can't talk, but evidently the station's not quite set up to transmit yet. I tell my ham club to watch your show in Ham Nation. Thank you, John. Appreciate that very much. They say, who am I to tell them all about ham radio? Guys, there are about 1,000 hams in my county. He's in Lacey, Washington. About 1,000 hams in his county. It's hard to find someone to talk to. They've got 5 repeaters in the county. So he'll keep watching the show on Ham Nation. I'm going to have a hard time getting through this part. I'm out of work and money to give out. But I did save $5. All my ham things need to come later. I go to the library to watch your show. My CPU died. 73, John, KD7. I want to make everybody a 4. KD7, ISO. Thank you, John. This show is for you. If you are, I always solicit contributions. Arvin is sitting over my shoulder there, inviting you to stop by hamradionow.tv if you enjoy the programs. If you can afford it, if you've got the rent paid and the kids' college tuition is covered well enough, and you know, things, stuff like that, you know, we should be fairly low on your list. But if we can be on your list, that would be nice. Where did my brain go? What's next? Oh, there was more. I got a contribution from a guy named Joe Ham. Joe Ham. Yeah, very funny. If you want to remain anonymous, I appreciate contributions, but Joe Hamm, very funny. He says, I've been learning a lot. My hope is that you post more than you have in the last couple of weeks. Okay, Joe, we will. And I replied to him, thanks, Joe. We just completed the radio review, sent it off to the ARRL. I've got a couple of programs in production. I'm releasing more this week. I completely understand. He says, I completely understand. And he is catching up on some back episodes. And hang on just a second. What is this? Somebody's calling me on my Skype line. Who's calling me here? Who are you?
Well, this is Joe Hamm, KC1BAQ.
Joe Hamm. Sure. So, okay, stay anonymous if you want.
Yeah, that's what most people think, especially when I meet him at the Hamfest. When I got my license and joined the local club, they said, all right, you know, what's your real name now?
So you are actually Joe Hamm.
Yeah, the last name is H-A-M-M, spelled with two M's. I think somewhere back in our history, they thought it didn't sound as porky to have one M versus two M's, so they added another M on it. I think it was originally H-A-M.
Cool. So you did send me a contribution to Ham Radio Now, and we exchanged a little bit of email back and forth. And to begin with, you were wondering if I was going to shoot some of the conferences at Dayton this year. So I guess the first thing I'll do is explain to you and to everybody that I'm not. At least I don't think so. Cliff and I are going to go down there, and we're going to travel light, just going to be doing the tour stuff. I think we may carry two cameras, but we're going to keep it very, very simple. And the reason for that, and I don't know if you were watching the program at the time, but I tried a Kickstarter to fund going to Orlando and to Dayton and was not successful. It missed by a lot for a lot of reasons. I don't know whether the number one reason why was people didn't really care, but it didn't make enough money for me to bring all the stuff and do everything I want to do. I'm probably just kind of barely limping my way there. So I take it you're not going to be able to go to Dayton this year.
Well, that's why I sent you the money. I was thinking, you know, well, I haven't seen a video from him in a week or two, and I thought, I hope he doesn't get discouraged. So I was like, well, it's definitely been worth the money I've sent you and probably more. So I wanted you to know that people were watching and appreciate what you're doing.
I appreciate that. There'll be lots more shows. I have been, as I was explaining before you rang me up here, that I've been busy doing a bunch of stuff, the ARRL review of the Yaesu radios, and I just sent that off. That was killing me. I had an anniversary and went down and shot an Eris contact. So it's just been very busy with things that don't produce, at least not immediately, any content to go on the air here. So, but the reason I'm excited that you called and is that you're, besides being Joe Hamm, so now everybody, this is what Joe Hamm looks like. And I've been a ham since 1965. I'd be 50 years in January.
Congratulations.
And Joe Hamm has been the generic name for every ham that we didn't have a specific name for since long before I got started. So everybody,
right.
this is what Joe Hamm looks like.
I'm the stereotype.
Yeah. But you're also a relatively young ham. You're in your 30s?
35.
Okay, right smack dab in the middle. And a fairly new ham.
That's right. I had I was an electrical engineering major in college. They had a station there at Auburn University. I got my license, then never really did anything with it. Poor college student, barrier of entry. There wasn't the cheap Bofang radios or anything at that time. Didn't have a lot of money. I let the license expire. Didn't have an Elmer to get me excited, get me pulled in and see what it could do. And so I guess the end of last year, I started thinking about it, and I renewed my license, got a new call sign in January, and then upgraded to general a month later.
So you had to go through the testing stuff again. You couldn't just renew. You had to take the test again. So start with tech and then up to general?
Yeah, I'm studying for my extra now, so hoping to get that soon.
Okay. Well, then your interest in ham radio started years ago, you know, what, 15, 20 years ago?
That's right.
But didn't hang in there. Tell me a little bit about that. What got you interested at first? Because there's a lot of people in electrical engineering in school that don't get interested in ham radio. And I don't know why. That doesn't make any sense to me, but they don't. So what caught your interest and then what what fired it back up?
It seems that a lot of the people that come to Ham Radio come for a variety of reasons, but a lot of people actually had somebody, a personal relationship, somebody that invested in them. I never really had that. And so while we had a station and some of our professors encouraged us to get our license, there wasn't a lot of that hand-holding and that encouragement and that mentorship at the time. And now I was at a stage in my life where I married and have some kids, and I was looking for a hobby and a way to get back involved in the community, especially with public service. And so there was a lot of things. I couldn't say there was one reason I got back into ham radio. It was probably a lot of different reasons. And anyway, here I am. And I found a lot of great Elmers through the local club.
I was going to say, it's instructional that in school you didn't have people that were giving you the one-on-one. They were hams there. Mm-hmm. When they had a club going, but they didn't give you the one-on-one that you needed to keep your interest going, and that doesn't seem right.
Well, I can't really blame them. You know, I was a college student. I was involved in a lot of things that weren't always academic, and so had a lot of distractions too.
Okay. Well, so you're back. Had you kept touch with what was going on in ham radio in the intervening years, or did you lose contact entirely and then just remember it?
No, I lost contact entirely. I went into computer networking and worked. My career was mainly in computer networking and information security, and so I was interested in a lot of digital technologies, but radio was completely just left it for a number of years and just recently rekindled an interest.
So how did that happen? Was there a specific event or a person that you ran into that got that spark going again?
There was a couple people that I knew. Actually, I live here in Connecticut. My landlord is a ham. He's not that active, but he had mentioned it, and so it got me thinking about it. I ran in. There was a couple conversations I had here and there with some folks. I started, you know, wondering if ham radio could be used to set up networks similar to what we had done with the commercially available services. And so that's one of my interests other than public service is, you know, like stuff like the digital modes, especially email communications, data communications with like the advances and Pactor 4 and stuff. And so I don't know if you want to talk about that, but the limitations that I quickly found out we had here in the U.S. was troubling to me.
I do. What kind of networks were you talking about wanting to set up?
Well, it seems like, you know, we're as a newcomer, I was kind of surprised to find that the rest of the world doesn't seem to have the same limitations that we were governed here by the FCC. And so that was kind of a concern. I can't buy the best modem technology and take advantage of the advances. And it doesn't seem like a lot of the people in the U.S. are that motivated to actually make advancements because of some of the limitations. It seems the rules are antiquated. They were written a long time ago, and a lot of those restrictions don't apply anymore.
You probably have a better understanding of them than I do. Give me a little bit of detail. Let's talk to an audience of hams that don't know a lot about that, not the experts, and give them a little bit of education. What is it in our rules that is keeping you from being able to do what you would like to be able to do?
Well, I'm not an expert either, but when I came into this hobby, it seems like a lot of the people who are using, like, say, CW and RTTY, they're concerned that if we remove the baud rate restrictions for digital modes, that for some reason it's just going to crowd the band. Well, all that information is, I mean, you can already use a 3 kilohertz signal for digital modes within the same band. It's just we're removing the restriction of how much information can we put through, how fast can we put information through that same bandwidth. So if we've changed the rule today, you're not going to instantly see a bunch, you know, anything significantly different tomorrow. You're going to see more people developing technologies to be more efficient in use of the spectrum, and that's a good thing. That advances the radio art.
You know, one of the things, as I keep looking for what it is that has hams who may or may not operate much digital, the main thing that I have, I guess, finally got it through my thick head to understand is that people are worried that if someone comes on the air a little bit too close to the frequency they've been operating on a digital signal, especially with all the variety of digital signals that we've got, there's no way to just tap them on the shoulder and say, excuse me, I was here first. Have you been playing with some of the digital modes, and have you encountered that situation?
You know, it's just as likely that the reverse would occur. A lot of the new digital modes sound like noise or indistinguishable signal, and so it's just as likely that a CW or RIDI operator would step on a digital signal than the other way around. I think somebody who's respectful would not be doing that, and I think that for a long time that we've, you know, I say we, but the ham radio community has found ways to play nice with each other, but still not squash advancements in the radio art. And I'd like to see, you know, us work better together to do that. And I think if you make some rules around automated stations, or maybe the software now with the modem technology can easily distinguish if there's already a signal there before it starts transmitting.
The ARRL has filed comments with the FCC, or a petition to eliminate the symbol rate thing. And, you know, we're going to see where we go from there. Will that solve the problem? And one of the things that I keep thinking of is I would actually like to go all the way back to what we saw proposed back in the mid-2000s, the regulation by bandwidth thing, where we have a little bit of spectrum at the bottom for narrow signals, a little bit wider in the middle for wider signals, and then wider yet for wider signals, and put anything in them that you want, anything that you can stuff, analog or digital. My crystal ball is too cloudy to know whether things would really work well if we did that. But it's sort of my vision of the future, and then we make it work the way you're talking about. How does that sound to you? Is that kind of the direction you'd like to go?
I don't know. You've been around longer than I have, but here's something that I do know is that a lot of other countries, they don't have as many regulations. There's self-regulation going on. So the way I see it, the more that we play well together and can self-regulate, the less the government has to get involved. And so if we can learn how to be nice to one another and cooperate with one another, then it's not going to be as big of a problem. I'd encourage your listeners to go out to the FCC website and look at all the comments that have been posted on that proposal. And I mean, almost all of them are very negative from CW operators. And I think most of them are just, some of them just say, I strongly oppose this, you know, but they don't say why. I think a lot of it's emotional, and a lot of it's driven by fear that they're not going to have an opportunity to do the portion of the radio art that they enjoy. And I just don't think there's a conflict there. It doesn't have to be.
What kind of modes do you operate? Do you spend a lot of time on actually getting on the air on digital modes?
I'm new. I've just, through Aries, you know, I got exposed to the WinLink system, RMS Express. They do a lot of stuff locally, you know, on VHF, UHF, but I've been doing more with WinMore. I don't have a hardware PAC-DOR modem yet, but that's probably the next step for me. It's kind of like, do I buy a PAC-DOR 3, which we have the right to use now, or do I get a PAC-DOR 4, which we don't have, and I don't know what the FCC is going to do, and so I don't know which one to buy. And so, but that's, and I've played with like JT65 and some of the other stuff, PSK31.
There's sort of an in-between mode that lets you get on higher speed PAC-DOR called WinMore. Have you played with WinMore?
Yeah, I use WinMore right now, which is a virtual TNC. It just emulates the hardware. That's what I've been doing right now over HF, yes.
Yeah, WinMore is one of those sound card modes. So you fire up your computer, run WinMore, feed it into a sideband radio. And how does that compare to PAC-DOR 3 and PAC-DOR 4 in terms of speeds? Now, PAC-DOR 4, we can't operate. And that's the highest speed PAC-DOR available now, right?
Yeah. I'm not an expert on it, but you say you got PAC-DOR 1, which they say that WinMore beats PAC-DOR 1, maybe like the equivalent of PAC-DOR 3. PAC-DOR 3 is obviously better than WinMore. There's been debate on that about how WinMore is depending on the conditions. But PAC-DOR 3 is supposed to be really good over weak signal and that sort of signal degradation. PAC-DOR 4 like doubles PAC-DOR 3, you know, again. And so, and I think they're actually working on more advanced modes than that. This market is kind of primarily monopolized by the German company SCS, and they have their proprietary modems and everything. I would like to see more American engineers and, you know, experiment with this stuff, but I think probably there's some motivation taken away because of the FCC regulations.
Yeah, that's another one of the issues about the advanced PAC-DOR modes. There's just one company making the hardware for it, and they're fairly expensive. I think they're in the, $1,500 range or so?
Yeah, for a low one. You can buy a used, if you can find a used one on eBay, sometimes you can find a PAC-DOR 3 modem used that was put out around the 2001, 2003 era for $800. But a new one's going to cost you, say, $1,400, $1,500 all the way up to, like, say, $2,000 or so.
Yeah, I know here in North Carolina, our Aries group across the state is using Pactor. They're using Pactor 4, and in fact, they have, I'm not going to say abandoned ham radio, but they have all moved over to Mars frequencies so that they can use Pactor 4. And they have that set up between the state EOC, the three main branches of emergency management, and a few counties are starting to come online with that. So they like the idea that, first of all, there's no interference. The frequencies that they're on, they're the only people that can be there, and they can use Pactor 4. So
it's unfortunate that the ham radio community, which coming into it new, and I read about the history, has long, you know, advanced the radio art. It seems like we're terribly behind in actually taking part in the development of these things. You know, it's all being, you know, it's being controlled by proprietary companies. So the military uses this kind of technology. Other countries, people experiment with this stuff. But in the United States, it seems to be severely limited. I don't think there's any reason why we can't figure out a way to move forward.
So it sounds like what you would like to happen is the rules to permit expanded and more technologically advanced methods of sending digital communication, and the engineering community to come together and make the hardware that we can do that and get away from the very proprietary highest speed stuff that's available right now.
Yes, and do it in a way that we're not actually trampling on the existing amateur radio community, the people who've grown up and they've loved CW, they've been operators for years and years and years. I think there has to be a solution that is a win-win for everybody.
Yeah, and I think that's my bottom line too, is that we can't abandon our legacy, and we can't just say, too bad for you, we are going to stomp on you. But we can't let not being able to figure that out stop us from making progress. So someplace we have to find a happy medium, someplace meet in the middle.
Yeah, I don't know if this is necessarily a generational problem, because there's a lot of older hams that are into digital modes. But if there needs to be some kind of cross generational cooperation, where, you know, the older generation, we want to make sure that they're not, that the way they use ham radio is preserved, and that they can look at, you know, us or the younger generation as those who are going to be carrying the torch forward, and allowing us to advance the radio art.
Okay, do you do any CW?
No, I don't. You know, when I
do
first
even,
got my license.
Do you even know CW, young man?
When I got my license and originally in 99, to go further, I would have had to learn CW. And that was probably an obstacle for me at that time.
So that is maybe some of the reason why you got back in now, is because that wasn't going to be a requirement.
That would have been an obstacle for me.
So this is pretty sad. Here's a guy who's only an electrical engineer, who wants to worm his way back into ham radio because now he doesn't have to learn CW. That is really sad. I'm kidding. That's well, awesome.
No, I mean, it's true. I find it interesting, but I don't necessarily find it. I agree that it shouldn't be required any more than I think that, you know, I should be required to learn how to send smoke signals.
I've heard that argument, and it's, yeah, maybe smoke signals is a little bit extreme, but
I agree. I was just trying to make a joke. I mean, yeah. I'm not trying to be derogatory towards CW at all, but you have to realize that we live in a different generation, a digital age, where there's a lot of other technologies available, a lot of other ways to communicate, and I think that it was smart for them to remove that.
Well, maybe the more cogent argument that I've heard is that, why should we have to learn Morse code? Why shouldn't you have to learn digital code, some kind of computer programming, you know, to get a ham license? I don't think either one should be required, but somebody in your generation or even younger could make that argument very well, that is a more necessary skill in today's technology.
Yeah, actually, for a ham radio operator today, it would probably be more beneficial to know how to program than it would to know how to send code.
Yep. But Morse code currently hangs its hat on that it's fun.
Yeah,
it's
absolutely.
It's useful and it's fun. It's a skill that you can take pride in learning if you want to. And as I understand it, more and more people are doing that because now they're not required to, so they're just doing it for fun and they're having a good time. Yeah. Do you do any of the digital voice stuff, or is the text and file transfer stuff pretty much your bailiwick?
I saw your show with Bruce Perens, and I've downloaded FreeDV. I've been having some trouble getting it working with my sound cards here on my MacBook under OS X, but I'm still playing with that the last several days. I'm very excited about that.
So it sounds like something that will be fun when you can make it work.
Yeah, I see that as an open codec for digital voice seems like the way of the future. I wouldn't be surprised if in the next 10 or 15 years that most people are actually just using digital voice, especially if you can find that with weak signals and weak propagation that is actually better than sideband. It's going to be a no-brainer.
If it gets to that point that he's talking about, yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, there's plenty of things that in the traditional ways that we use ham radio, I don't see how digital voice is going to work if our point of view is to emulate those things. A DX pileup, I think, will be very difficult in digital voice. I was asking him how these signals handle mutual interference when signals are overlapping like crazy. But on the other hand, I can see something that is completely different, where we have our signals lined up carefully. The stronger signal is going to have some capture effect, and so we're not overlapping, but we are still competing. And you got to have the better signal or some form of better way of using the technology that I can't even think of right now that will catch the attention of the station that you're looking at. And I could think of software like the CW skimmer that goes across the band and looks at all the signals and lays them out on a display. Well, you can't do that with voice signals today, but you can do them with digital voice signals, especially if they've got a little data tag saying what they are. So it could be a totally new world.
I think 50 years from now, you'll still have your guys with their old sideband rigs.
And I think we should.
Yeah, absolutely. I don't think it's going to go away.
Yep. But room for something else. And there seems to be room on the bands for doing that. Well, I appreciate your contribution, your interest in the program, and for ringing me up and showing us all that there really is a Joe Ham. And I've got a couple other things to do that you might be interested in as I'm finishing this program up. Would you like to hang around for a minute, or do you got to run?
Absolutely. I'll stick around.
Okay. So let's see what else I've got here in my brain. Well, there was another email that I got from someone asking me if I was going to be in Dayton, and his specific interest was going to videotape Bruce Perens' talk. We were talking about Bruce Perens a moment ago. Andrew, M1 DNS, pointed out that Bruce Perens, K6BP, who's been on the program several times, is going to do a forum on Friday called Ambi Exposed, FreeDV and Codec 2. He already talked about that a little bit in the last episode that we did when we talked to him about it. But what he's saying here in the description of the talk is that Ambi has been reverse engineered. So there's a D-Star receive application that works without the DV dongle, without the Ambi vocoder. The developers would like to remain unnamed for now due to intellectual property reasons, which I guess that means that it is not the patent is not expired. Yeah, so we can't actually use this yet legally. You know, some of that happened with the original digital voice mode that eventually became FreeDV. I don't know if you followed any of the history of that.
No, tell me about it.
The codec that they were using when that first came out, and I did a program called Digital Voice for Amateur Radio. I did that on DVDs. There's some ancient technology in 2008. They came out with a program called WinDRM. And that was the original digital voice program. And it used a codec called MELP, multiple excitation, linear properties, all that stuff I don't understand. It turns out that MELP was a easy to get codec. It was available on the web. You could download it and put it into this program. I think they even gave it to you with a download of the program. But it had an issue. It was not a public domain codec. It was owned by a conglomerate, a bunch of folks, including the federal government, which pretty much paid for getting it developed. The thing Melt did was it did a really good job of low bitrate voice vocoding, which is what Codec 2 is doing, the open source one. You know, lets you narrow down your digital voice signal until it could be, at that point, for a WinDRM, a couple of kilohertz, fit easily within the width of a single sideband signal. And they used that for a while. If you look at the video, Mel Whitten, who was my interview subject, didn't discuss the nature of MELP. But if you look at the video, you'll see in the little window of the program, you'll see Codec, and it says MELP, MELP. So we know that's what they were using. And they used it for a couple of years, and then somebody decided it would be a wise thing to do to check with one of the companies that had the intellectual property for it. And that company had to say no. You know, no, we can't give you permission. One of the reasons they could is they didn't own it exclusively. It would have to have been half a dozen companies that got together and all said it was okay. And that's the kind of thing in this business that just very hard to do. So instead, hooray, David Rowe in Australia has developed Codec 2, and now we're just beginning to see the fruits of that labor as we have a free codec that will do better than MELP and will continue to be developed. MELP's not being developed anymore. So off it goes, and we'll see where we can go from there. So that probably has you pretty excited.
It does. I find it very fortunate that I came into ham radio for this, for a time such as this. You know, it seems like a very exciting time for people to get into the radio hobby.
It is. And again, the folks that look at all this stuff and say, I'm scared, you don't have to do it. And there's room for all of us to play. And as you said, we need to be aware of each other, that if you're operating a digital signal, that you're not stepping on someone who's operating an analog signal. And if you're operating an analog signal, which is, as you said, probably the more difficult one, because all the digital folks sound like just noise. Your S meter goes up, but your speaker doesn't register anything besides just a little bit more noise that you might think is coming from the power line.
We still got guys who you know, they tune up on right on top of a voice signal. So
yep.
You ever been talking on sideband and somebody comes on and hear you?
Well, that's kind of my other point, that if you're worried about interference from another signal coming along and bothering you, well, that happens plenty when you're both on the same mode. And, yeah. And how well has it worked to tap them on the shoulder and say, excuse me, I was here first? Or, I've been using this frequency for 45 years.
Right.
What do you mean you got here first?
That's right.
Okay. So moving on. So yeah, Cliff and I'll be going to Dayton, and we're going to be traveling light. So we won't. I'm sure I'm going to be at Bruce's talk, but I'm not going to record it. But I'll talk to Bruce, and we'll do an interview, a short one, and add some more to it. But most of what he's talking about was already in the program. If you go back and watch the previous episode,
are you going to be recording any of the sessions?
No, because it takes, at least for me to do it the way I like to, it takes three cameras. It takes one on the speaker, one on the audience, and one on the slideshow. Mm-hmm. You can do it cheesier than that, but you miss what's going on, either of the speaker talking or the slides or whatever. I guess I want to keep the standards up.
Are you going to walk around and take some video of the floor?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, what I'm thinking that I'll do, I'll probably stop by some of the big manufacturers if they'll still talk to me, and many of them won't anymore.
Why not?
Because I've been mean to them. I'm not tame. You watch any Leo Laporte?
Yeah, and you don't sell out, you know, for advertisement.
Yeah, I would take money for advertising. I've done that. Leo calls journalists who basically just read press releases and let the people that they're interviewing from companies say whatever they want, you know, basically just to promote their product. He calls them tame journalists. You know, okay. They get the invitations to Apple. They get the invitations to Microsoft.
But
I'm not tame.
Yeah, you're respectful, though. I mean, I've watched your episodes. You ask difficult questions, but you're not disrespectful in any way.
I try not to be, although one of the very first ones that I did down in Orlando, the first day I was doing Ham Radio Now, I was kind of nasty to Dennis Machenbacher from Yaesu. I was trying to be clever, and I said, well, what do you want to shill today? And that was not nice. The thing that made him the maddest at me, though, was that the next year at Orlando, Jeff and I went over to the ICOM booth, and I know Ray Novak, and Ray, he wasn't feeling real well, and he didn't want to go on camera, so he let us play with the new, at the time, the ICOM 7100. Jeff and I played with that a lot. And I've had an on-and-off relationship with the guy from Kenwood. We were in his booth at Dayton a few years ago, and he had the new 9900 that was under plastic, and they had a drape across the back and didn't want anybody to see what the connector arrangement was on the back, because the radio was still a prototype, and it may have been a long way from what it was eventually going to be. Well, being the journalist that I was waiting for the interview and said, I'll just shoot a little video of the fact that there's a drape. And he saw me doing that and said, you're out of here. Get out of here. Okay. Goodbye.
Well, let me tell you, I don't know if you've ever been in sales or not, but all those sales guys, they have a thick skin. So don't take that personally. you got to have a thick skin too. And I tell you, if the audience loves you, then the manufacturers are going to have to love you.
Well, I'm not trying to burn any bridges. I'll keep trying. We'll see what they'll do. But I think what would be more interesting, besides the one or two new radios that typically get premiered at Dayton, is to go see all the little guys. Because there's 100 little guys who are also trying to premiere a product, and they get almost no attention.
That's where a lot of the innovation is.
Yeah, so I want to concentrate on those. I've done that, but I've done it more accidentally. In previous years, I had the mindset that the important thing was what was coming down from ICOM, Kenwood, and Yaesu, and Flex and Alacraft. The Flex and Alacraft guys, I get along with real well. I think they see the forward-leaning direction of the program, so they're very happy. I haven't managed to piss them off yet.
If you're trying to maintain the status quo, then you're probably not going to want to come on the show.
Yeah, and I know ICOM and Yaesu and Kenwood don't want to maintain the status quo, but they're more status quo-ish than Alacraft and Flex. Hey,
can I ask you a question? Have you heard any rumors about new radios coming out?
No, no one's told me a thing. So, but I wouldn't be surprised. And right now, is a couple weeks out, is when you start hearing some rumors. In the past few years, it hasn't been as big a deal for absolutely surprising new technology being released to Dayton. It's just, we used to see more of that. Yeah, we're gonna have a great big announcement. You make sure you're at the booth at 11 o'clock. So we'll see. But I haven't seen anything leaking anyplace or hinted at on QRZ.com or any of the places you'd see rampant speculation. So.
Well, maybe if we get some of these FCC rule changes through, maybe we'll see more innovation.
Yeah, very disappointing that there'll be nobody from the FCC there this year.
I didn't know that.
I think they're still doing the sequester thing, and they're not going to spend the money, or so they say. But, yeah, nobody from the FCC coming. So, let's see. What else have I got here? I'm going to take your picture off the screen and put up this one. I've been seeing a continuous trickle of comments from this program and some other programs as well. This is it's the seventh episode, seven. So I did a whole bunch of programs in episode two. So this isn't the seventh thing I put out. In fact, if you look, it's not numbered on YouTube, but it's the program that I did on DMR 2 years ago. And a lot of views, 11,865 views. But the thing people have been complaining about, and here's the latest one, is the host interrupts too much. Please shut up. And you'll see a bunch more of those. You know, folks that think I really like the sound of my own voice, they're telling me that I should shut up. And I thought for a while that they were kind of right. That was an early program, and There was a lot of back and forth, but I kind of had the tendency to, I would like to call it a lively conversation. I don't know if you think I've been interrupting you too much.
No, I think there's another popular radio show that rambles on a lot more than this one.
Yes. Which one is that?
So well, I'm not we'll guessing. Not, we'll not
we
name
can,
anything.
We can name anything we want.
No, I'd rather not.
Are the initials HN?
Well, I mean, I enjoyed that show too.
Me
I
too.
Just, I think it could probably be just as good if it was half the length.
Well, and people say that to me all the time. You know, these programs run typically an hour. Let's see what my counter says here. Yeah, we're at 35 minutes, and I did about 10 minutes before we got started. So we're in fine shape right now. In any case, I went back and I watched that whole show. And you folks that think I interrupted too much, you're full of crap. Jeff had a lot of expertise. Jeff Parker, WA1WXL, was the expert on DMR. But DMR wasn't the only thing we were talking about. We were talking about D-Star, and we were talking about other digital voice stuff that he had little expertise on, and I had a lot. So we were batting things back and forth. And yeah, I may have jumped in maybe a little more than I had to, absolutely. But as I watched the program, it is very informative. At that point, we were thinking maybe the Yaesu radio that was going to come out would be compatible with Moto Turbo's DMR or DMR Moto Turbo. I get yelled at by the non-Moto Turbo guys if I say Moto Turbo. It's DMR, damn it.
Everybody knows what you're talking about.
Yeah, yeah. But they get their undies in a bunch.
I should say it's never rambling when you're doing the talking. You know, if I'm doing the talking, it's never rambling, right?
No, it never is. But
I wouldn't apologize for it. It's your show. Do it how you want to do it.
Well, yeah, I kind of have that attitude. But I played it back, and I enjoyed listening to the whole show, myself and Jeff, and I thought it imparted a lot of good information. So you guys who think that I talked about too much, I don't think you were listening to what I had to say. I think you were concentrating on the fact that I was interrupting the guy that you thought was going to say more about what you wanted to hear. But in a conversation like that, the professional broadcast talent needs to bring the conversation along. For example, Joe, if I were to put you on here and say, do a show, are you ready?
No.
And now the Joe Ham Show. Ladies and gentlemen, here's our host, Joe Ham. Take it away, Joe.
No pressure, right? No pressure.
Yep. So Jeff was a very good guest, but it was not a show for Jeff to be monologuing about his interest. I needed to be there. So that is that.
I have something that I'd like to, I don't know if you plan to already bring it up or not, but the passing of Tony Montero was very sad to hear about.
Oh, yes. And Tony was, I didn't know Tony well, but Tony did an episode with me. Did you see that episode on from Dayton last year? And I don't know what his health was back then. I was kidding him about, he was saying, we're all very excited. And I was saying, yeah, I don't seem very excited. They're all, you know, pretty low key. This is a Sunday morning interview, and Dayton rings you out. And if he was going through health trouble at that point, well, that could have been why, and he didn't say anything about it. But yeah, I mean, what an awesome talent and resource that AMSAT has had that they have lost. So
yeah, big shoes to fill there.
Thank you for bringing that up. So yes, absolutely. The next thing I was going to bring up was Gary Wadke, WW8N. We talked about his tower. And an update from a couple of weeks ago, he has a signed and dated permit now for the first 40 feet of his tower, pending the final outcome. And his lawyer still thinks, yeah, this is going to be going through. They won in the Ohio State 6th District Court of Appeals. They dismissed the appeal by the village. The village has filed a motion to reconsider. The village that he lives in must really be upset. I don't know what the deal is. I mean, they keep getting slapped down, and they keep coming back. And they must have plenty of taxpayer money to spend. In any case, he expects that he'll win that final appeal too. He says he truly expected it. And I put some ellipses, some little dot, dot, dot here, because he said, you don't see it here. He said a few other things that I'll just leave out. This has got him very frustrated.
It's a family show.
Yeah, but sort of. Okay, so the last thing I wanted to bring up, and you might want to weigh in on some things like this. I just happened to be noticing as I was perusing the programs that I watch and the networks that I watch, a lot of technology stuff. Twit is the only network with a ham radio show in it, Ham Nation.
Yeah, yeah. And hey, by the way, maybe you'd like to share some of the things that you commonly, some news sources you commonly.
Well, I'll dig into this. But Twit is the only one, and that I think is because Leo Laporte was interested in ham radio and had a somewhat personal relationship with Bob Heil. It all started in one of the triangulation episodes a couple of years ago. So Twit has got Ham Nation. Now, Ham Nation doesn't look like any of the other Twit shows. Those shows don't all look the same. There's a variety of expertise and professionalism, but Ham Nation is by far the most amateur of the shows on the Twit network. I think it's probably right down the alley of what they want. I don't think they really want a more professionally produced program. I think they're happy with what they're getting. But on the other hand, there's a bunch of other networks. I listed a few of them. CNET, Revision 3, Guys from Queens, 5x5, Frog Pants. Those are networks that I watch programs on pretty much all the time. How much do you catch any of those?
I watch some of them. I don't really keep up with all of them. I definitely watch Ham Nation. And when I can catch it live, I'll do that on Wednesday night, or I'll see it on Thursday morning when it's posted on YouTube.
Yep. And not all the programs on all those shows are technology. Like CNET is pretty much all technology. The other ones, they have a variety, but they lean toward the technology-oriented people. And then there's the broadcast programs. Ham radio is in the background and occasionally gets a little foreground more than a cameo on Last Man Standing. But I wrote down three shows that it would seem to me that hams would be right front and center in these programs, and yet we're not mentioned. Big Bang Theory, which Leo doesn't like. Don't know why. Betas. Did you watch Betas on nope. Where did that run? Amazon, I think.
No, but I haven't. Is it on Amazon Prime?
Yeah, you can watch it free on Amazon Prime.
Okay, I'll do that.
Yep. It's a Silicon Valley startup show. Kids doing a Silicon Valley startup. And Silicon Valley, which is the one that is very much like it, that I think that's running on, it's on something I can't see. It's HBO or something, some paid walled service that I can't see it, but they put episode one on YouTube. Anyone can go watch Silicon Valley episode one. I heard somebody finally on one of the other tech shows comparing the two, and they said they're exactly the same. They're a bunch of kids. They develop an app. They go through the mills of the incubators. They get slapped down. They get big offers that they turn down. They get mentored. They get disparaged, and on they go. I think I heard that Betas is going to be canceled, and Silicon Valley will probably keep on going. The technology in those programs, at least in Betas, that I could watch the whole thing, it rapidly became very background to all of the social stuff. The
drama.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, they wanted the tech-oriented audience, but they wanted a bigger audience. So that Big Bang Theory has got more actual science in it than any of these programs did.
They should do a show about makerspaces, all the things that are going on from week to week in a makerspace. That might be an interesting show.
Yeah, I kind of wonder about the maker movement. Ham radio would like very much to be in the maker movement. But before we talk about that, you haven't seen some of these shows, but to me, it seems like ham radio ought to be an element, not the primary thing, but one or two of the typical four or five people in these programs ought to be a ham. And why aren't they? Why don't we have that? Are we too old? Are we aged out of that demographic? Are you the last ham standing?
I don't want to be overly critical of the community, because the ham community has been good to me and embraced me since I've got my license. But I think that there's a lot of room for improvement for reaching out to the younger generations. I'll just say that.
Well, you know, this program is all about not polishing the turd. And,
yeah.
And
well, I think, well, you know, we'll take the, some of the polish off. I mean, there's, I don't know what all the answers are, but I'm looking for the answers and I'm looking to be part of the solution rather than just complain about the problem.
Well, that's a good attitude. I can't tell you how many club meetings and board meetings I've been at that somebody will bring up, you know, I need more kids in ham radio. And all of the usual not quite solutions are hashed out one more time. If there were any easy ones, I think we would be employing them now. I think I know what makes this work.
Go ahead.
And I think I know why it's not happening. And this kind of applies to a lot of things in ham radio. We can't do it. The radio club should encourage more youth participation. Radio club can't do that. Radio club doesn't have hands, doesn't have a mouth.
Yeah.
It takes an individual or
right.
two or three that this is what they want to do. This is the thing that they want to do in ham radio is to work with kids. And I've seen a few clubs that very specifically dedicated themselves or a group of people within the club dedicated themselves to do it. And they would get 5, 10, 15 teens to early 20s interested and into ham radio and licensed. I don't really know where it went from there. The one club I'm thinking of, a fairly local club, not doing it right now, probably because the person who did it didn't want to do it anymore, moved to another area, doing it someplace else. I don't know, but someone else didn't pick it up. So it can be done, but it can't be done by us. It has to be done by you.
We live in a culture where we want to outsource everything we don't want to do. I don't want to do my laundry. I'm going to drop it off at the dry cleaners, and I'm going to join a club that's supposed to promote all this stuff. You know, it's kind of, if I can use the analogy, you know, I'm a Christian, so like I see that in a lot of the churches. You know, people join a church and expect the church to do all the work in the community rather than people doing it themselves.
Same thing. So, I mean, that's not the whole picture by any means, but that's going to be some of it. So hopefully, people watching may say, yeah, that's what I want to do. And I do get email from young hams, not as many as I'd like, but saying that, and from hams like you that say you're learning something from the program. I'm not desperately trying hard to teach stuff here. if something is educational and you learn something, that's sort of a byproduct.
What do you mean by that?
Well, education is the kiss of death for a young person. Come learn something. I don't want to do that. No, come have fun. And
that's
if you accidentally learn something, well, then cool.
That's right.
And the other thing that is important to me to understand, and I'm not the only one who said that, a notable like Riley Hollingsworth has said this, getting your license is not the end of learning in ham radio. It's not. It's the beginning. It's raw beginning. Boy, when I got my general license, was I stupid.
Yes.
I looked behind the radio that my mentor set up. It was a separate radio. I had as a novice, a DX40 over here and an HQ110 sitting next to it. And on the back was this funny looking thing. Old hams will almost know what I'm talking about. It was a Dow key relay. It switched the antenna back and forth between the transmitter and the receiver. I had no idea what that was for. No idea. Just that dumb, and I could get a general license.
Yeah, it's the same. It's the same analogy of like when you get a college degree, like you're instantly going to know how to do the job, and that's not true. You need to have a good mentor, your first job, to help you out and teach you the ropes. Same thing with ham radio.
Yep. So, ladies and gentlemen, once again, this is Joe Ham, your average ham.
That's right.
Very wise, or at least very average.
Just very average. I'm just very average.
Yep. But I really appreciate your sending me the email and sending me a little bit of money and being interested in the show and for coming on today. I played like you just showed up. I try not to play act too much.
Well, thanks for having me. I don't know how helpful it was, but I appreciate you you taking the time.
We'll get email. If folks want to reach you, you're on QRZ.com. Your email is there.
That's right. It's KC1BAQ @ARRL.net.
Okay. So you'll get some email from us, I expect. Do you remember how we make this show come and go, especially how we make it go at the very end?
I just know you do the...
That's at the beginning. Okay, so I'll give you some stage cues here at the end. You said who you are. I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. Don't forget Arvin. There he is over my shoulder. HamRadioNow.tv if you want to do what Joe Ham did and contribute to the program. Stop by Ham. That wasn't hard to do, was it?
No, it was very easy. I mean, you can use PayPal.
Yeah. Did you have to do PayPal or do you do credit card?
I use PayPal when I can.
Okay, so but you could use PayPal or you could use a regular credit card, mm-hmm. Or you could do like John Kennedy did, out in Lacey, Washington. You could send me cash.
John. Do you accept silver?
It gets pretty heavy. Put a lot of stamps. You'll spend more money in postage than I'll get in the. And I got to look into that Patreon thing. I've been hearing a lot about that. So, okay, so we do our names, we do the promo, the pitch, and I say over, and you say?
Out.
Perfect. Thanks, Joe Ham.
Thank you.